July 20th, 1973, actor and martial arts expert Bruce Lee dies in Hong Kong at the age of 32. Bruce Lee had died just 6 days before the premiere of Enter the Dragon, a film that would make him the first Chinese actor to become a true Hollywood star. But how come that such a powerful man, who many believed was an immortal superhuman, could have died so early and so unexpectedly? Rumors started quickly spreading across Hong Kong that Bruce Lee's family is hiding something and that there was a trace of a woman and drugs. Okay, so how did Bruce Lee actually die? Sit tight, as we're going back to the summer of 1973 to uncover the real circumstances of Bruce Lee's death, and we'll show you exactly how it was. Bruce Lee and his family were spending the first half of the year in Hong Kong, where Bruce was busy with two things: finishing up Enter the Dragon and shooting the new film Game of Death. The producer of those two films was Raymond Chow, founder of Golden Harvest, a film production company based out of Hong Kong. Raymond and Bruce were the best of friends. On July 20th, at around 8:30 a.m., Bruce Lee woke up and did his routine morning exercises for about 45 minutes. He would typically stretch, do some cardio on a homemade stationary bike, practice Jeet Kune Do, and lift weights. His mornings were intense, but never too exhaustive. 10:30 a.m., Lee arrived at Golden Harvest to work on the script of Game of Death with Raymond Chow. Somewhere around that time, Lee ate a small amount of hash, as he believed cannabis expanded his consciousness. In 1970s and 80s, chewing cannabis was the thing in Hong Kong, especially popular among the wealthy people. 1 p.m., Bruce Lee jumped into his red Mercedes-Benz and drove away to 67 Beacon Hill Road, where on the second floor in a one-bedroom apartment lived his mistress, Betty Ting Pei, a 26-year-old Taiwanese actress introduced to Bruce by Raymond Chow. Apparently in Hong Kong, not many people knew about the relationships that Bruce was having on the side. According to the book Betty wrote about Bruce Lee's death, that day when he arrived, they had sex and some more hash. Later in the evening, Bruce and Betty had a dinner appointment with Raymond Chow and George Lazenby, a Hollywood actor who Bruce Lee wanted to invite as a guest star for his new film, Game of Death. 6 p.m., Bruce complained of a headache when Raymond Chow arrived at Betty's apartment to pick up Bruce and Betty for the dinner. At 7:30 p.m., it was time to leave, but Bruce's headache only got worse. Betty gave Bruce Aquagesic pill, a quite common prescription medication, and Bruce said that he would like to take a nap and to have some rest. 7:45 p.m., Raymond Chow departs for the dinner with George Lazenby, alone, as the three agreed Bruce and Betty will join them as soon as Bruce feels better. In between 8:15 and 9:30 p.m., from the restaurant, Raymond Chow telephoned Betty number twice, asking when they were planning to join them. First time, Betty said that Bruce was sleeping. Second time, she said that Bruce was still sleeping, but she was about to wake him up. Afraid of disturbing him, Betty opened the door slowly, crept into the bedroom, kneeled down beside him, and whispered, "Bruce, Bruce." He didn't respond. She pushed his shoulder and said a little louder, "Bruce, Bruce." But he still didn't wake up. Panic rising, she shook him and shouted, "Bruce, Bruce." Betty called Raymond back at the restaurant in hysterics. She couldn't wake him up. Raymond told her to come down and raced across town to Betty's apartment. When Chow arrived at the apartment, he found almost naked Bruce Lee lying flat on Betty's mattress, not breathing. Chow realized that it was too late. His star was already dead. Okay, at this point, let's try to imagine what was going on in the head of Mr. Chow. The most famous man in Hong Kong was dead in his mistress's bed, and the two of them were the only witnesses. The scandal would consume them. The press would blame them. It could end their careers, maybe even put them in legal jeopardy. If Raymond's original goal was to save Bruce Lee's life, now his immediate goal was clear. Bruce Lee had to die somewhere else besides his mistress's apartment. Chow told Betty to call her personal physician, Dr. Xu. When Dr. Xu arrived, he tried to revive Bruce for 10 minutes. No success. It seems likely that Raymond Chow explained to Dr. Xu the gravity of the situation and pleaded with him to drive Bruce's body to Baptist Hospital, where Dr. Xu worked at the time, and which was only half a mile away to limit the number of witnesses. Instead, Dr. Xu decided to call an ambulance to treat a person who had collapsed and insisted that the patient be taken to Queen Elizabeth Hospital, which was 25 minutes away, rather than the much closer Baptist, presumably because he didn't want to bring this radioactive scandal to his place of employment. It took 7 minutes for the two paramedics and the ambulance driver to arrive at the scene around 10:30 p.m. The paramedics couldn't find a pulse, and the patient wasn't breathing. They performed CPR and gave him artificial oxygen. There was no change in the patient. The paramedics carried Bruce to the ambulance. Raymond Chow and Dr. Xu jumped in back with them. A little after 11:30 p.m., telephones across Hong Kong started ringing with the news. Bruce Lee was dead at the age of 32. The cause of death was unknown. The autopsy report will later show that Bruce Lee had died of cerebral edema, swelling of the brain, presumably caused by an allergic reaction to the painkiller given to Bruce by Betty. The funeral ceremony in Hong Kong was attended by 25,000 people, and 3 days later, Linda, Bruce Lee's wife, buried her husband in Seattle, where they fell in love and started their journey together when life was simple and where they were happy the most. So this is the real story of Bruce Lee's death. This is how it was. All right, if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and don't forget to hit that notification bell and you won't miss the new episodes.